So let's have a very interactive session now. How many of people have smartphones? Everyone. Okay. So now as we all know smartphones, and what you understood about the arrhythmias? Have a little bit idea of arrhythmias? Dr. Tanu explained it very well. We can't get it more simpler. See, anything which is abnormal, which is not going to the normal rhythm, it's arrhythmia. It seems as a very big term and all that, but if you follow the basics, the arrhythmias can be very interesting to study. So arrhythmias are usually whenever there is an irregularity in the rhythm, or there is the mechanism from which the rhythm starts from SA node, go to AV node, go to ventricles, it gets disrupted, that defines as arrhythmias. Now, problem with arrhythmias, they mostly are paroxysmal. That means patient complains of arrhythmias, but by the time it reaches us, we can perform the ECG, the arrhythmia is gone. Or the patient is in a very remote area, the ECG is not accessible to the patient, so we don't know. Whenever he then gets that facility, the arrhythmia is not there. Or sometimes the arrhythmias are silent. So asymptomatic, our basic purpose is to identify these asymptomatic arrhythmia detection, or the arrhythmia is there but the ECG facility is not there. So we try to help by them all these new smartphone using that can be identify the arrhythmia and the help in the medical treatment of the patient. So there was a small study which was done that how much is the asymptomatic arrhythmia burden in our society, and it was basically seen in elderly population. They found that a patient like more than 65 years of age, they have 6% patients have atrial fibrillation, which is asymptomatic. 97% of the patients have some premature atrial complexes or premature ventricular complexes, which didn't have to be addressed, but yeah, they were present there. And SVTK was occurred in 85% of participants, while NSVT in 27% of the participants. And all these were asymptomatic. The problem with arrhythmias is the patient having arrhythmia, the most common is atrial fibrillation, and it remains undetected in especially elderly population. And why we are so much worried about atrial fibrillation in elderly population? Because we all know that it increases the risk towards developing a stroke or a heart failure, and if not properly treated, can lead to morbidity and disability. So various, since it is paroxysmal in nature, various modalities are there which we can monitor the ECG for a prolonged period. The commonly or the most oldest one is the Holter monitoring, in which you put the patient and ECG electrodes are there. There is an ECG recording, but that maximum is for 24 to 48 hours. And the patient has to tie the electrodes around itself, but the detection rate of arrhythmia is less than 10%, because it's not possible that the patient may have arrhythmia during that time period when the Holter was tied. And it is cumbersome and not patient friendly. The other one which can be used for a longer period is an external loop recorder. This can be used for days to weeks. It has a better diagnostic yield than Holter, but still the patient has to tie it around himself, and while taking bath or dressing or undressing, he has to remove that thing. Then came your implantable loop recorders. It is implanted subcutaneously and they had a battery life of 3 years, and they record your ECG for 3 years. If any arrhythmia is there, they detect it and then they notify it. But all these things are invasive and it's not very patient friendly. I won't say doctor, but patient friendly. So there was the modality, which is smartphone technology, which was started 10 years back. We all know about the smartwatches. How many of people have smartwatch which monitors your heart rate or physical activity or how many calories burned? You all are aware, I think so. You all have an Apple Watch or something, you have seen it, okay, this much calories burned, this much, my BMI is this, I sped, I walked, took this many steps. So all these have your health monitoring parameters. So we went a little more ahead. Can this be helpful in diagnosing the arrhythmias also? So a little data was that if we say the Indian population, whether the smartphone is feasible, it was very interesting that 60% of Indian population will have smartphones by 2022, which is more than a toilet facility visit to an Indian. So we are more smartphone savvy now. So there were these smartphones, how these principles started. One is a common, not a very technical thing. It's a smartphone face photo plethysmography, or it is also developed by a cardiorhythm. And the other one is a smartphone-based single lead ECG, which was developed by a life core or ECG check. The common one is a photoplethysmography. I think we all have, I just have a small presentation. We all have a smartphone and we usually can download a health app or something. So our smartphones are inbuilt with a camera and a light. And if we just pressure, okay, measure my the heart rate and we press the finger on this, the red light get activated. And it will record my pulse depending on my the pressure volume. So my tissue is expanding with the blood, each pulse, and this is recording my heart rate. Can you see the pulse waves? So now this is calculating my heart rate is 116, I'm anxious. Okay, so it gives me a roughly idea, okay, my heart rate is 116 and it is not normal. But it cannot tell me that whether it is my heart rate is regular or it is just a sinus tachycardia or it is your atrial fibrillation. So this application is accessible to everyone, but it doesn't give any added report that what this is an arrhythmic or a non-arrhythmic thing. So it gives just your label of it. There is no ECG recording and it cannot differentiate between whether it is a premature beat or an atrial fibrillation. It will just give it's a regular rhythm or it's an irregular rhythm leading to your total heart rate of this. The other technology which we started with this main thing which records the ECG is a, which was started by Aliveco, now it's known as a cardia mobile or a cardia band like thing. It got FDA approval in 2012. It's basically a two metal electrodes they provide you. They can, you can attach to your back of your phone cover or you can have carry in your pocket. And you keep your right and left finger on the electrode. So if you keep a right and left finger, which lead you ECG you will get it from the MBBS students? Yeah? Good. Lead one. So lead one will be recorded on the ECG app. So when you keep the two fingers on this, it transmits the signals which we are coming from this to ultrasound signals, and these ultrasound signals then again changes to your star digital ECG tracing, and you get a beautiful ECG tracing on the app monitor. You have to download the app, but it will give a beautiful ECG tracing, labeling it as a, what was the heart rate, whether it's normal, whether it's irregular or a regular phenomena. This was a mobile. The other one, which they came with a cardia band. It's just like an Apple Watch. In this, what they have given, one electrode is attached to the dial of your watch. The other electrode is just below the wristband. So for the ECG recording, you just have to keep your finger, because if you're wearing your watch in your left hand, keep your right finger, and it will again say as a lead one ECG. The added advantage with this cardia band is that it is recording your ECG, or it is recording your pulse continuously. So whenever it detects, no, there is something different, some difference in the pulse or some difference in the electrical activity, it gives you a signal, okay, there is some arrhythmia, you just take your ECG. That's the added advantage which you don't get with the cardiac mobile. So it requires ECG for 10 seconds and then it labels it three reports. There is it normal or is it is your possible atrial fibrillation or it is unclassified. Unclassified, sometimes you get too much disturbances, too much patients can contact or there is sweat or something. Then it is not able to interpret the rhythm and it labels it as unclassified. So these are these apps. These are these common practice, but how reliable are they? How much like a doc physician should rely on these apps? Okay, whatever the report it's giving, is it correct or not? So is there any data to support it? Now, various studies have been done to assess these apps. The one which was the largest research AF trial, which did in 1,000 pharmacists, and they gave a two algorithm. One was the patient was with a cardiac band, and the other with the patients with a normal regular ECG, and they both were analyzed by a blinded cardiologist. And they found that the sensitivity of this app making a report of atrial fibrillation is 98% and specificity of 91%, which was very good enough. What about the other arrhythmias? There was a trial which was done, a SPHERE trial. They did a 35 pediatric patient with known history of arrhythmias. That means that there were known cases of supraventricular tachycardia or atrial fibrillation or VT. And they asked the patient, whenever you have symptoms, just record your ECG by a cardiac band. So what they found, if the patient had this is from a sample tracing which they provided, that if there was atrial fibrillation or supraventricular tachycardia. So what they found, they when the patient died, depending on the diagnosis, that the transmission interpretation what there, So patients with SVT, 25% time when they press the cardiac band, it was diagnosed as SVT. And when they press, 39% sinus rhythm and 31% as sinus tachycardia. This was very well correlating with the ECG reporting and with the cardiac band reporting. So if the patient, and within 24 hours of the reporting, the patient was again contacted by whether any treatment to be given or not. Whether it's just a sinus tachycardia, we were asked the patient nothing to worry about. So it was patient friendly also, because he didn't have to go to the doctor every time he has symptoms. He just had to use to the mobile app, and the report was given to the patient within 24 hours. There's a recently published trial in Circulation which evaluated reverse AF study. The problem is the atrial fibrillation nowadays is like considered to be a very high risk factor, especially in elderly. We have now become a more elderly population, and asymptomatic AF now having increased risk of developing strokes or your heart rate failures. So they analyzed patients who are more than 65 years of age and they have a chart test score of more than 2. That means they have an increased risk of developing atrial thrombosis event. They followed for 1 year, and to their surprise, there were 19 patients which were diagnosed as AF by your electronic ECG, as compared to only 5 patients who were kept on just routine care. Routine care, whether ECG in a month or ECG in 3 months, depending on the patient's accessibility. So the all patients were diagnosed with an AF by the electronic ECG. The p-value was 0.007. And if the chart test score was more than 4, there were increased risk for developing atrial fibrillation. So what about the compliance? What the people, patients were happy? They were not patients, they were a regular population, regular elderly peer in the persons. So they were very well satisfied. The satisfaction rate was 98%. So there was no, patient was not worried that something is tied around my chest or something. He just had to press the two electrodes and his ECG was delivered. There's a recent article in 2018 which was published. Again, it showed that automated AF detection by smartwatch technology has a good sensitivity and specificity. What about the photoplethysmography, which I just showed? Whether can it be relied for your AF detection? Since not done, a pooled data analysis of 14 studies, they have shown, okay, you can tell the heart rate measurement, but you cannot tell the what type of arrhythmia is still going on. So further studies for photoplethysmography is needed. What's in the future? There is a new CBR phone which is getting developed. These are the wireless electrodes, which are just like a 12-lead ECG. They can tie around, just stick around the patient's chest, and they just take the signals from the electrodes and convert into microcontroller and then transfer to the smartphone. So should smartphone ECG technology be the smart option for everyone? Like from tomorrow, you all will be showing the cardiologist, see my heart rate is going 140, what to do? Should everyone use this? No, it should be just initial stage, real world data we don't have still now. It can be used as a screening tool when we suspect there's a patient of high risk of atrial fibrillation. If there are symptoms of palpitation and ECG is not easily accessible, or in cases of monitoring of atrial fibrillation treatment, whether the paroxysmal or heart rate is controlled or not. But there are fallacies. We all know we are giving technology into patient's hand. We all know we are giving Facebook, we are giving WhatsApp in the patient's hand, and what ruckus we are creating all around it. Small fake news can spread like anything. Same with technology, when we give to the patient's hand, there can be some fallacies also. Overuse of technology and real world data, the acquisition and all that we have to face. So still it's in the initial stage. We cannot comment that it's a very useful modality. So in concluding, smartphone X-ray based arrhythmias devices are currently validated basically for atrial fibrillation. They are a good tool for diagnosing your positive findings of NEA, and caution should be used when assessing these data, as validation in real world setting is still underway. Thank you.